Good evening and welcome to the People's Republic of Brighton and Hove takeover of the vote on latest TV. I am joined by the wonderful Jason Smart, the founder of the Republic.
The talking man blouse, if you also know. Who have we got on today?
We're going to launch straight in. Any pleasantries? You're not going to ask me how I am?
I have to pretend. Okay, how are you, Deb?
I'm very well, thank you. Thank you for your concern.
That's fine.
Anyway, but that's...
How am I? Yeah. So selfish.
Yeah, no, I am. That. I really don't care. Our first...
That's fair enough.
Our first guest is Ric Morris. Hello, Ric.
Hello.
Yes. Thank you very much for joining us. So you're from the Only in Brighton tour.
That's right.
Which is very exciting. So tell us about your tour and what you've been getting up to.
Well, I've been doing this tour since 2011.
Okay.
And basically it's a 90-minute walk celebrating everything that's unique about Brighton.
In 90 minutes?
Well, yes.
And it's a walk?
It is, yes.
Wow, brilliant. I'm Jason, by the way.
Hi, Jason.
That's fine. Right. It was meant by a 90-minute walk. So,
yeah.
90 minutes of all the kind of weird and wonderful things that we love about Brighton. Is
yeah,
that kind
absolutely.
Of the tone
so,
of it?
So there's obvious things like the Royal Pavilion, yep. And also lots of little weird stories about the Prince Regent and all his shenanigans
his
with
antics,
his lovers
and
his drinking, kind of setting the tone for the
Are
city.
There actually tunnels under the pavilion that lead to various places where he used to have illicit?
Well, there's the tunnel between the dome and the pavilion.
Right.
Supposedly so that the Prince could visit his horses without being seen.
His horses?
Yes.
His horses? Right.
The Brighton Dome used to be the stables for the predecessor to the Royal Pavilion, yes.
Why did he not want to be seen visiting his horses?
He let himself go a bit.
Oh.
Yeah, so he was a bit embarrassed
He was a bit body conscious.
He was.
Oh, I know. Yeah. There's so many layers to him, isn't
there?
That's really emotional. But what else is included? I mean, obviously you don't want to say everything that's included in the tour, but a flavour, a taste of what people can expect.
Yeah, well, there's the People's Republic. After the 2015 general election, that famous map of blue, and
that's
I show that in my tour.
Excellent.
About
we're included.
You are included. Wow. You are included, and the first and only, of course, Green Party Member of Parliament. I talk about the weird building material of Brighton, known locally as bungaroosh.
The kind of flint
rubble composite that has been called the worst building material in the world.
It's horsehair as well, isn't it?
It's basically anything
Any
solid put
stuff.
In lime mortar. So bits of wood, bits of broken brick, shingle from the beach.
I've got a house and you just bang a nail and the wall falls down.
That's right, yes.
it's not a house, it's a shed, but we don't. Let's not get into that anyway.
It's a sad story, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, it really is.
Deb's dungeon, that's where I live. That's just... Anyway.
I'll talk about ABBA winning the Eurovision Song Contest and becoming famous in Brighton.
Incredible, because not everybody knows that, do they?
No.
Some people say, well, where did they... Because it was, what year was that?
That was 1974,
singing Waterloo at the Dome.
I had one lady on the tour that insisted that it was at the Brighton Centre. And she wouldn't accept that. I've been doing this tour for years. Yeah. It was at the Brighton Dome.
Oh,
and there's a plaque outside now.
Oh.
Now behind scaffolding.
Did you put that up there just in case there's any more arguments?
There's not going to be any more arguments.
I think England didn't vote for them, did they? I can't remember now.
No, Britain gave Sweden no points whatsoever.
We had taste.
ABBA got the lowest percentage winning points of any winning song in the history.
And look, it did not matter because they've gone on to great things. Let's not talk to our friend here about
ABBA
because he's not a fan.
They've reformed.
But my mum's a huge fan. Hello, Mum. So she's going to be very happy that
she's not watching this.
Hello, Mum.
What else? So, what else is on the tour? So lots of things in kind of that area of town.
Yeah,
North Lane.
The world's first body shop.
Yes,
Anita
Roddick.
Yes. And all kinds of stories. And there's a bungaroosh connection to that. Supposedly, that building in Kensington Gardens, when she first acquired it, it had lots of mould and damp stains in it because of the kind of cheap building material.
Yeah.
So the only colour paint was dark green, hence the dark green colour of the body shop.
Wow.
And I mentioned the notorious Argus headlines.
Oh,
well,
they're famous, aren't they?
Yes, they are, yes. Infamous.
And the very first civil partnerships to take place in an English registry office.
Yes,
in
was
Brighton.
Here in Brighton. Actually, one of our previous guests, Aaron Burns from the Brookstead Ale House in Worthing, he and his partner, they were the first, because they live in Hove, they were the first couple to have their civil partnership converted into a wedding.
Oh, lovely.
So they're a part of history as well. So that's a nice connection between a previous guest and our current guest.
And I've had people, a couple on my tour that said, because they said, oh, we were the fourth people to have a civil partnership on the same day. So
it's lovely. That is a part of history for the city, though, isn't it? So in terms of the 90-minute tour, is that something that you came up with yourself through research?
Yeah, I came up with it. I was in the pizza restaurant on Jubilee Square, and I was just thinking, oh, so many unique things in Brighton. And I'm a tour guide by professional training. I thought, aha. And it just came to me, and in true genius style, I wrote it all down on a napkin,
within
a few minutes.
Amazing. And you've been doing that since 2011. When are you doing your tour? How can people book onto it?
Okay, so generally it's April to October, most Fridays and Saturdays, unless I've been invited somewhere else. But during the fringe...
Got a wedding or something
Exactly. During the fringe, it's Friday, Saturday and Sunday evenings at 7pm.
Okay.
Every weekend, apart from one Saturday.
Because you're going to a wedding? No.
How much is it to go on?
Oh, it's £10 or £8 concessions.
That's really good for 90 minutes. Yeah. That's a bargain.
Can I talk about my other tour as well?
Yes!
Only during the fringe. I do another tour called Peers and Queers, which is the LGBTQ history of Brighton.
Okay.
Looking at some of the sort of characters that have passed through or been connected with Brighton from a queer perspective.
Uh-huh.
And that's on Saturdays and Sundays at 1pm.
For how long is that tour?
That's 90 minutes as well.
Oh, another 90 minutes.
Can you only do 90
minutes? It covers 200. That's the ideal amount of time.
Yeah, 90 minutes.
Leave them wanting more, really.
Yes, definitely. Exactly.
Do you have half time where you have an orange or something?
No, just leave.
So, for your LGBTQ tour, I suppose that must be, because where we're stood now, we're stood in the kind of Kemp Town area, is that a lot of it?
Actually, start in Regency Square and then finish at the Marbler.
Yes. Oh, of course. So, fantastic. And does that include a lot of LGBT venues and...?
It's a bit more historical, so it's more about the people, the characters, the lives and the context.
Can you tell us about
lives,
a couple of the characters?
One of my favourites is Dr. James Barry, who was born Mary Ann Bulkley in Ireland at the end of the 18th century, then turned up at Edinburgh Medical School as a man and spent his entire adult life presenting as a man.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And this is 50 years before the first woman was openly allowed to qualify as a doctor in British medicine.
When was this?
So this
roughly?
Is the beginning of the 1800s. So the first woman doctor in British medicine by a full 50 years, depending on how you define the gender. We don't know whether Barry...
Did he practice in Brighton then as a doctor?
Barry was a personal doctor for a man who, in the last 2 weeks of his life, visited Brighton at the Bedford Hotel, which no longer exists, and they spent 2 weeks here. Lord Charles Somerset. And he, when he died in Brighton, he was buried at St Andrew's Church on Waterloo Street.
Okay.
The first person buried.
And he was
there.
A
so
woman,
fascinating. So his doctor was Dr. James Barry. Yes.
Wow, brilliant.
So your historical LGBTQ tour goes right the way back.
It goes a long way back, yes. I like to make people aware that there's maybe a lot more history than we might expect.
Yes,
we are known as the gay capital of
England. We are indeed.
Yeah. Or the San Francisco of England, which is great.
Absolutely.
Just haven't got the weather, So that's two tours that you're doing. So you're all going to be busy over the next month or so.
Yes.
Excellent.
You've got sturdy walking boots.
I have.
Excellent.
From a local shop.
Can I ask the LGBT? LGBTQ tour, how long have you been doing that one? Is that the
same amount of time?
Same amount of time.
11, yes.
Okay.
So every Fringe, and people seem to keep coming back every
Excellent.
Year.
Excellent. So, and do you change them over time, or do they?
A little bit. They sort of adapt and I sort of find new facts and things. Yeah. Mm. Yeah, a little
Excellent.
Bit.
Excellent. That sounds really exciting. Yeah, definitely.
You're going to go on it then?
Yeah, I think I am. I like a walking tour, definitely.
Where do you start from? When do you finish the walking tour? Did we say that?
In terms of the dates?
No, actually where you start from.
Physically. Yes. Okay, so the Only in Brighton tour meets in front of the Royal Pavilion shop.
Right.
Okay, yeah.
And Piers and Queers starts from Regency Square.
Okay. Do you go back to that spot after 90 minutes?
Oh, right, okay, no. So they're not circular. So right. The
Only Brighton in Kempton or something. Make your own way home now.
Only in Brighton starts at the Royal Pavilion shop, and then we go up sort of North Lane, then end up on the beach, right. Far from the pier. Then Piers and Queers. It's kind of a walk between the two piers, so Regency Square, and then finishing at the Marlborough.
Excellent. Gosh. Well, we are going to get all of your details on our Facebook page. There's probably been some pop up on the screen as you've been talking as well. So people know that, as if by magic, so people know how to book in. Thank you so much, Rick,
Cheers,
for coming
Rick.
In and speaking to us. Thank
okay,
you.
Pleasure.
It's part two.
So welcome back.
Thank you very much for staying with us.
Hey, we've got a real treat for you in this half of the show. In fact, this half of the show is where it really comes alive, by the way.
Okay.
Yes.
Is there no pressure. No pressure guests.
No pressure guests and so on. Because, seriously, we've got representatives from the artist open houses with us.
How do we afford them, Andy?
Well, I don't know. Whatever it is you did to bribe them.
Oh, right. Okay. Shh.
Judy Stevens. And Jehane Boden Spiers, an artist.
Ooh.
Do you want to invite them on, or shall we just talk about them?
No, we'll just talk behind their backs.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a bit rude, isn't it?
It is a bit. Let's invite them on.
Okay.
Welcome. Right.
Come and join us, please.
Welcome to our world.
Delighted to be here.
You say that now.
for those of you who followed us from the radio here to the TV thing, it's great to have Judy back. She came and hung out with us in the radio studio when we're on proper radio, as opposed to radio for TV. Judy, this year's open houses. What have you got to regale us? I'm so excited. Come on.
Yes, it is very exciting. We've got over 200 open houses.
Yes.
Well, 202?
It's 204.
Wow.
Have you met Mr. Pedantic here?
covering every area of the city, from Portslade right across to Camp Town, out to Rottingdean, New Haven, and up to Ditchling and Hassocks.
Wow.
So, every single space you could think of.
And it's a great looking brochure you've got this year.
It's very
full and everything, isn't it? It's like, I love that.
Yeah,
it's like,
200 venues with over 1,000 artists.
Wow. Mm. You've not come in alone, Jehane. You've come with Judy, and I'm really pleased to see you because it'd be lovely. You're opening a new open house in the Five Ways group, is that right?
Yes, that's right.
You've got connection with Five Ways, with open houses that goes back, is that
yes,
right?
Yes, that's right. Yes, my story of open houses goes back to 1996,
right.
So over 20 years.
Yeah.
And also, I think Judy and I have known each other most of that time. And in fact, I was in your house.
Many years ago,
quite pregnant.
As part of the open house.
As part of the open house.
It kind of makes sense to
realise now.
So my house, I have opening again after a 5-year break.
Right.
So it'll be the 13th time, I think, that I've ever opened my house. And prior to that, I exhibited in other people's houses.
Because is it a thing unique to Brighton, this open house thing?
It started in Brighton, right. But it's now inspired lots of other cities, Cambridge, Oxford, I think, all over the country. It's been a really important thing, I think, that started in Brighton.
I think it's actually all over the world now.
And it started in Brighton.
It started in Five Ways, in fact.
Ah, yes, it did. Which is where you've joined.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about the pains you've had to go through to open up a house, to go into the process, because this is a new home.
Yes.
You wanted some peace, some quiet.
Yes. So you opened your house to a festival.
That's right, yes. Well, We were just talking about having to create space to wrap all of the pictures and the things that we'll be selling over the month. So we've been concertinaing our cereal packets, one into the other, to get as much as possible into the kitchen cupboards to create space for bubble wrap in another one. And in fact, this year I've cleared out my garden shed for a fellow Five Ways group member, Philippa Stanton, who's doing an installation.
In the shed?
In the shed.
In the shed?
In the shed, so you have to come. It's called Blade of Grass. And,
Do you have any stories of people taking extreme liberties with your open house?
Well, yeah, you do get funny stories. I remember one lady came in once and raced up and down the stairs and opened all of the cupboards, kind of quite sort of frantically. And then it's all painted white in the house, makes the art kind of look good. And I remember a lady come in once going, "Wow, it's all white. I'm going to go home and paint my house white."
So that's basically for interior design hints.
Yeah, paint your house white.
Just to check your house out.
Yeah.
It's your personal space, though, isn't it?
Well, it is and it isn't, you see, Andy, because by the time you move all of your, a lot of furniture, you take all your personal belongings away to create a blank canvas to put the work up. So it doesn't actually feel as personal as it might be to you coming in. But of course, if you're an artist, it's actually more personal to put your art on the wall than it is to open your house. So,
That's true,
You have to put yourself out there with your work.
I kind of wonder what happens behind the scenes. How much room you lose. How many kitchen tables do you have on top of your bed? That sort of thing.
Well, I stubbed my toe this morning on a chair in my bedroom that's not normally there. So, yeah, you're clambering and...
You're really suffering for the art, aren't you?
But it's also really good for getting your house tidied, getting all your junk cleared out, getting your walls repainted.
Over my house just to clean it.
That's really good.
So what kind of art do you do?
I'm a textile designer.
So
there's pattern stuff.
Yeah,
we'll have to get some of that.
Pattern stuff.
Pattern stuff, yeah. Love pattern stuff. In fact, yeah, you love pattern stuff, Jason, too.
I do.
Went to that.
Jehane's work?
No, Jehane's work is better.
Oh,
I've seen some of Jehane's work. It's much better than that.
It's better than this photo.
Maybe we'll get some pictures up.
We didn't say it was better than this.
Great.
She's number 10, by the way, in the Five Ways tour listings. So, you
number
know.
10.
Number 10 on the
Who's
Five Ways.
Who's in number 9, Andy?
I don't know. I can look it up. It's on the page and everything, but they won't be as good. They'll be good. You know, don't
they'll
get me wrong,
good.
But they'll be differently good. Well done.
Cheers.
Very diplomatic.
So it's basically like textiles, you mean like pattern or... What is this? I was trying to think of what it is.
Why not? So I personally have got a couple of ranges in the house. Yeah. One is based on embroideries and collages of Brighton landmarks and poems and old maps, using things from the reference library, local people and poetry and scenes, and also some lovely patterns. There's a red damask pattern that I've put onto tea towels and wrapping papers and cards, especially for the festivals. So,
that's
one of the great things about it, is that people can buy things that really aren't necessarily in the shops, and it's a very special way to buy work, isn't it?
Kind of cuts out in the middle. Men like galleries and all that stuff.
Yeah, to a certain extent.
And I think actually meeting the artist and knowing who you're buying the work from is something very personal
and criticising
quite
their
different.
Fridge.
Well, you know.
I might do.
I'm very
as long
conscious.
As you don't criticise their art.
That's wise words.
Have a go at the fridge.
I'm very conscious that you're handling all the logistics of it. Over 200 people, over 1,000. Oh, mind you, do you sort of semi delegate each house to manage, curate their own?
Yes.
No,
so I think it's a really important part of, because each open house has maybe up to 10 guest artists.
Right.
So part of the thing of doing an open house is you curate all your artists. So it's a really nice sort of curation experience to allocate spaces to your artists and really to design how all the work's going to work together in a domestic setting, which is nicer than a gallery setting.
Do you handle all the kind of artists coming in centrally at all? Do you basically say to a venue such as Jehane's, well, if you're looking for more artists, here's another list of people?
On our website, we've got artists upload little samples of their work and links to their websites, and then
like
anyone
house?
Well,
are you a bit like a clearinghouse for
you could look at it like that, but it's a facility that you can find artists on our website.
So it's 200 open houses, you said,
just over.
It's widespread as well.
And it's widespread around the area, but also it's a big community event. So we include schools and we include, there's a lot of venues maybe for artists who might be otherwise excluded from, from the art world through learning disabilities or mental health issues, or some people who've experienced periods of homelessness and drug and alcohol abuse issues. So it really does pull, you know, everybody is welcome to take part in the open houses. If they live in the...
I'm really proud it started in Brighton, I didn't know that.
And it's really grown enormously. So I think, you know, it's really, what's important is that we have a lot of really major artists and makers, and but also a community.
Nicely alongside, inclusive festival. Have there been any challenges curating your space?
Are there artists that you kind of had to gently say without naming names?
I can honestly say no, no.
So you've got your own exhibition in your own house, but with other people as well?
So, my involvement with open houses was initially to sell my own artwork. And then when I opened my house, I invited other artists, you know, as well.
Yeah. How many have you got?
So this year, there's 17, including myself.
You've got a big house.
Or they're crammed in, I don't know.
Yeah, well, to be fair, there's maybe 8 or 9 that have got a significant amount of work. Sure. And then half a dozen, maybe there's a couple of pieces.
In the cupboard somewhere.
In the cupboard.
Yes.
But, some of the artists are there to make a reference to a second open house that set up this year. The first time that I've done two over in Kemp Town, so just up the road from here. So it's kind of making a visual link as well.
But I think also if you've got jewellers, for instance, they don't really need such a big space as somebody with very large paintings.
Yeah, that's true.
17 people. Impressive.
I'm looking forward to it. I really am. I can't thank you enough for popping on the show. It's brilliant and it's really worth doing. The festival is every weekend until the 28th.
That's right, yes.
Four weekends.
And two bank holiday Mondays as well.
Excellent. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.